Welcome back to Less Code, More Power. Today, we're seeing part two of the Application Lifecycle Management episode. If you didn't see part one, go see part one, then join us. Hello, welcome back to Less Code, More Power. I'm your host, Dona Sarkar, and my lovely co-host is...
Sarah Critchley. Hey, everyone.
Hey, we are back with part two of our two-part series on ALM, aka Application Lifecycle Management. If you haven't seen part one, pause this, go see part one. You're not pausing. Go see it and then come back because you're going to want to know what we said last time so you can understand what we said this time. So don't skip to the spoilers. Trust us, you will not understand what we're talking about. So today we're back with Phil and Mark talking about how anyone in the world can actually use ALM to do their work better, not just traditional developers. Phil and Mark, thank you for coming back and joining us. We didn't scare you off.
Good to be back.
We're a little scared, not that scared.
Not that scared.
All right. So just recap for us, Phil, what you shared about what is ALM? Why would people use it? What are some cases to make people's lives way the heck easier?
Yeah, last time we talked about application lifecycle management. Like, how do you manage the application as it transitions from development to test and to prod, and then over time as it keeps getting upgraded and moved to through different environments, test and production, as users provide more feedback and as developers collaborate on creating it and maintaining it. And we talked about how to use solutions, Power Platform solutions, to combine all of the elements in the app so that you have a package that's easy to move. And we moved a couple apps, both cat themed apps. We moved our cat themed apps between test and prod to show that process.
So while we were moving the cat themed apps, you were showing us like, okay, this app is built on Dataverse. We're moving the tables. Mm-hmm. We're doing this. We're doing that. And the way to move it was packaging up into a solution, which you could deploy anywhere. We understand there's an easier way to do this, or there's a way that works for anyone in the world.
There is, yeah. So we did everything manually before. We packaged it up in a solution. Yes. We exported it manually. We imported it manually. But there's automation that can do this. And so, like, here on my screen, I've got Azure DevOps. And if you haven't seen Azure DevOps before, know that Azure DevOps is free for up to 5 users. So if you're using Power Apps, this is available to you as well. And so I have a DevOps pipeline created here. And I'm installing the Power Platform build tools. And then I'm doing the same steps that we did manually in the last episode, but I'm automating it. I'm publishing customizations. I'm exporting the solution. I'm also running Power Platform Checker to look for any issues in this. That's something I skipped last time, but we can enforce it here. And that's part of ALM and automating ALM, is to make sure our processes are consistent. And so that's one advantage automation gives us, besides just making sure that this moves without us having to do all these steps. And then this last step here, we're unpacking the solution, which is just a zip file of the app's configurations. And we're putting them in source control. And so source control allows us to see everything that's in the solution and track it as it changes over time. So if we need to go back in time to an older version, we can do that. And as we understand the contents of it, we can also compare to see what's changed.
And Phil, just to make sure the audience understand, right, once this is set up, that's it, right? It can then just be run and rerun, and essentially that's kind of the foundations of the ALM process.
That's right. It can even be triggered with Power Automate, right? It all comes together.
And Phil, do we have to do it with Azure DevOps, or do we have other options?
So we have another option over here too with GitHub. So GitHub is another place we can keep our source, and GitHub Actions allow us to do sort of the same sort of thing. We can export our solution, we can release it to prod. All the same sort of actions we did in DevOps, we can do in GitHub as well.
I love that ability to use GitHub Actions because it's such a good co-auth tool, where you can say like, hey, we want to collaborate on this thing, whether I'm a citizen developer, traditional developer, whoever, want to collaborate on this, collaborate on the data, collaborate on the app itself, and then move to whoever's environment we need to move it to. Sarah, I think this must be a life changer for you and your customers, where you're building things for them.
So much. Because yeah. The thing is, like, what it takes so much time, like the amount of time, yeah. Like, I mean, you know, I've had to work late before when I've been like doing this, all this manually all the time. And also when people are joining, like everyone has like their own process, right? And it's really hard to manage that. So that this really helps, like, kind of, especially, you know, as an SI, it really helps us to really say, this is how, like, the best standards are, and we can actually bring our customers along with it. And I think it's the same as well, like, if you're working directly with a customer, it's about being able to, you know, really show them those best standards as possible to make a repeatable process.
You know, and one of the things that we find is that even being able to do these things that Phil's already shown, there's still an additional learning curve to doing it and doing it well and doing it, you know, in a repeatable fashion. And so one of the things that we're doing as part of the PowerCap team, because we also build something called the Center of Excellence Starter Kit, is we're actually building reference implementations to make going from zero to ALM much more easy and much more productive. So I'm going to switch to my screen if that's okay.
Yes.
The first thing
you're making it fun. You're making ALM fun. That's what you're doing, right?
Mm-hmm. So the first thing that you're going to see here is an application that we've built that is actually doing quite a bit behind the scenes. It uses GitHub behind the scenes. It puts things into source control. It does environment provisioning. It does a lot of things. But like, people don't want to have to worry about doing that as a maker, right? They just want to come in. They want to do their work, and they want to move what they've built from dev, test, to product. And so this application is geared towards that persona, where literally all an end user about this app that uses this application has to know is that they can come in, they can request to create a new project, give it a name, give it a description, or through an approval process behind the scenes, right? Mm-hmm. They don't know that it's flow approvals behind the scenes, et cetera. They just know it goes through an approval process behind the scenes. At some point, an admin approves it, or some approver approves it. Behind the scenes, we provision Power Platform environments. We set up a GitHub repo. We deploy GitHub Actions to the repo, and the maker then just gets an email and says, "Hey, your project's been approved. Go do your work." So they come in, they click open their solution. Right, it takes them right to their work. They build out in their solution. They publish their customizations. They come back to this app. They say, "You know what? I'm ready to go to test." They click a deploy button. They can pick where it goes. You know, once it's gone to test once already, they can pick to move it to prod, for example, on a different project. And then ultimately, behind the scenes, again, a lot of things happen, including an approval process, which includes looking at source code. But again, the maker probably doesn't want to have to look at the source code of their app, because after all, this is low code, right? But we're exposing the source code, if you will, or enabling people to put that source code and that archive of source code somewhere so that admins and professional developers can go look at it.
This is amazing. This is like, honestly, I feel like I needed this for my entire career.
Now, yeah. The interesting thing is that if you give this application to a professional developer who's using the Power Platform, they're going to scream at you, right? Because they don't want all this stuff hidden. They understand words like git and pull request and, you know, commit. And they want to see the source code, and they don't want all the knobs hidden from them. So we built a completely different application, and I'll switch to that one over here, that is really geared towards advanced makers. And it really assumes you know what solutions are. It assumes that you know you're getting your code into a source control system, but it gives that easy button convenience layer over all of it, right? So I'm a developer. I get a work item for the day. Maybe it's been a couple of weeks since I've done some work. And I know other people on my team have been, you know, committing work to source control. I need to go get the latest. Well, we have an ability to go click import, get the latest from source control into my environment to build on top of the latest work from my collective team, right? Once I've done that, I can come in here. I can similarly open my application, go do some work in it, make some changes, right? Then I come back to this app. I click push changes to git. This just sort of puts that easy button layer over what Phil showed you. And if you actually look at our pipelines, they're pretty robust. They're actually the same pipelines that we, the COE Starter Kit team used to do our ALM. And so we're basically taking all of the work we've done for ourselves and essentially making it an accelerator for other people to be able to do what we're doing without that huge learning curve that it takes to get there, if that makes sense.
And yeah, so, this is awesome.
We also, you know, we enable things like pull requests, right? And so I think as this starts, where this starts to become very, very valuable, I always say, you know, we, whether it's low code or pro code, we've all painted ourselves into a corner when we're building something, right? And yes, Power Apps has this sort of history save feature where you can go back to a previous version. But what's really useful is if you can go back in time and see like the code and really drill down and narrow into something, right? So for example, if I pull up, let's say this one right here, I can actually drive into the source code for my app. And so this code that I just committed, I can come in and look at the solution as Phil was showing. And we are using this newly announced capability to unpack Canvas apps as source code, right? So you can come in here, you can look at the source for your Canvas app. I can see that, you know, some changes were made. So what is that change? I can just look at a comparison. I can see what happened from one point to the other, right? So I keep putting my code in. This is my little safe space where my incremental changes go. And then I go, oh, I painted myself into a corner. I go back to three check commits before. I see what I did there. I see the next one. I, you know, copy and paste the code. I put it in my Canvas app and I get myself out of that corner that I painted it myself into. And so even for low code folks, you know, having the access to a source control system becomes really, really valuable. Now, for us on the COE starter kit and for more complex applications, it gets even better because we do pull requests. A pull request in sort of simple terms is I want somebody to look at the work that I've done and approve that it's high quality before I basically bring it into my main application. And so we do those sorts of things. And if I look at a pull request in Azure DevOps here, guess what? We do things like builds. So none of the changes that a person on the COE starter kit makes goes in and is accepted until we do a code review on it. The code has to build from source control, deploy to a target environment. And for example, if I look at one of these builds, as Phil called out, we're using things like Solution Checker. So I can actually see that, for example, I added a screen into this application, still named Screen 1. That same app checker that you see in the Maker Studio is now here for the code review. And I can say, okay, first of all, it's not a good name. Second of all, it's not accessible, right? So I can go make those changes, or I can tell the person whose code I'm reviewing to go make those changes before we accept those changes to go out into a test environment, right? And so there's much more to how this application works, but it's really geared towards that traditional pro dev, you know, systems integrator who's using low code technology in really advanced complex ways and wants to have that full end-to-end application lifecycle management process they're used to just over the Power Platform.
Wow. Well, if you changed my life with the previous app, you've definitely changed it with this one. So this is amazing. Yeah. Like I have, and just a quick question before we then go ahead and like kind of summarize for the audience. Mark, sometimes you can have some like different work streams, like kind of doing this kind of stuff. Would the app that you just showed support that kind of stuff?
It does. So the app has been written to be extremely flexible, right? We've had this, unlike the previous app, which we took this principle of you want to guide people down a certain path without exposing all the complexities that are possible with the Power Platform. We had a completely different philosophy with this app, which is to say, we don't dictate anything about the ALM process. We do some defaults around branching, but you know, as you commit changes or you submit pull requests, you can pick any branch you want. So it enables, you know, to go to the far extreme of one developer per environment doing small incremental changes and committing often and submitting changes often to, you know, feature teams each working in their own environment to, you know, hopefully people aren't doing this, like lots of people all working in the same environment. We will support good practice and bad practice. We will certainly, as we document some of this stuff on docs.microsoft.com, we will share how we do branch management and merging and those sorts of things to help people down a path of success versus maybe introducing lots of issues in their solutions because they're all working in the same environment.
That's amazing. That is, honestly, I think this has given the audience just so much stuff to really get started with. So where are they gonna, people are gonna watch this and be like, where can we get this app? Where can the audience go ahead and get started?
So the first app is available today, aka.ms COE starter kit, and we'll provide the links. The second app is in private preview. We plan on or hope to go into public preview come right around Ignite. And if we aren't, if people are really interested, DM me or hit me up on Twitter and I'll get you into the private preview.
Brilliant. Wow, that's amazing.
This is huge. I love that you thought about all the kinds of developers we work with, from someone who might be just starting off with Power Platform, who needs to collaborate, and they may have never written code in their lives, or all the way to the traditional dev who's been living in, you know, a C++ world for 15 years, and they're like, in fact, I need to see my source code because I'm a control freak. Right. So I do appreciate that you've really gone to where the developers are. You're saying, like, if you're super familiar with Git and pull requests, we're here for you. But if you have no idea what that is and you do not care, we're also here for you.
Don't worry about it, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Exactly. And, you know, for customers like Sarah has and customers like we have, this is a huge game changer because you're not talking to a specific department or another. You're saying there's something for everyone. It does not matter where they're starting off. So absolutely. That is really, really lovely. Awesome. Thank you so much, both of you, for being here with us.
Thank you.
So, audience, please get in touch with Phil and Mark with any questions. You see their Twitter handles. And these two are some of the best in the world at helping people debug their thing and solve their problems. And we want feedback from you, because based on feedback from you, this is why we build products like ALM.
It's true.
Awesome. Thank you so much for being here. Till next time, less code,
more power.
See ya.
Thank you, guys.